Hello everyone, thanks for viewing this presentation. My name is Ruyman, Reyes, and I am the technical lead of different SYCL projects that we run in Codeplay, including the one I'm presenting today, which is adding CUDA support to Intel's DPC++. In case you haven't heard about us, Codeplay is an 80 people company that is based in Edinburgh. We work with compilers and programming models for different different customers and different markets. If you use SQL, you probably have used CompuCP. CompuCP was the first SQL implementation that is available on the market, and you can get a free edition from our website to play around. So what have we done and what we are going to be presenting today? So in this presentation, we're not going to go talk about CompuCP, but the contributions we have made to the Intel open source compiler, DPC++, where we have contributed a CUDA backend that allows SQL applications to run on Nvidia hardware without requiring OpenCL support at all. It's the native CUDA support. We have also some mechanisms to interact with existing code that I'll show later on. All the work in the compiler is open source, and everything is done in the public and contributed to the open source repo. And all the experience that we have gained during this project has been contributed back to the SQL working group, and we have come out with a number of extensions thanks to that experience. So we're going to present some of those today. So what's the relationship between DPC++ and SQL and Codeplay? So DPC++ stands for Data Parallel C++. So Intel calls this a programming model that incorporates a SQL standard. The way we see it is more that the DPC++ extends the SQL input upon one specification with a number of extensions that improve programmability and performance on some of hardware that is relevant for Intel. The aim for the DPC++ extensions is to become core SQL or core extensions, and there's a pretty good chance that some of them will make it to the next SQL version. We have been involved into this from early on, because once we learned that Intel wanted to have an open source implementation, we saw this as a good opportunity to contribute back to the community from an independent code base that we can just work without having any relationship with CompuCP. And it is also part of our activities inside the One API initiative to have a more wide programming model that can cover libraries and different hardware. Obligatory disclaimer, we are not associated with Nvidia for this work. We are doing this purely as Codeplay. And all the information we have used for the implementation is based on public documentation and code that is available everywhere. And obviously all users of Nvidia and the Nvidia logo are CUDA logos are registered trademark of Nvidia Corporation. So in this presentation, we are going to be first talking about how to use SQL for CUDA, where you can get it and how to install it, and basically how to run your SQL application there. Then we'll go and give an overall design view of how SQL for CUDA works with the SQL specification. Then we'll get into details with compiler and runtime implementations, and the different LLVM passes and the PI plugins we have written. And then we will move on to interoperability with existing libraries, which is an interesting feature that allows to use existing CUDA libraries with SQL code. And finally, we'll look into some conclusions and future work on things that we are going to be working on. Right, so how do we use SQL for CUDA? Actually, simple. You just need to get a binary package of DPC++ that you can get from the Intel LLVM releases. There is nightly builds coming from the testing servers that you can use, but there's also monthly releases that you can take that are a bit more stable. If you want to build it yourself or you want more details, you can just go to the Get It Starting Guide that is on the repo as well. And it's very detailed and tells you how you can build your application. Now, once you have your binary, then you have a Clang compilation. There is a normal Clang tip build, but now you have an and you have an option to build your SQL code. So that's the FSQL. And when you use FSQL, then you, your C++ code is going to be a SQL application. And what you have to add to build with CUDA is just add the CUDA target to your tuple. So if you add this, then when you build, it's going to be building a PTX device image. The PTX is the backend for CUDA. And your SQL application stays the same. And if you use a default selector or a GPU selector, then it will just work. And if you have a custom selector, then you have to be careful that you are not using something that will prevent the Nvidia device to be used. But the rest of the code can execute without any change. How do you run it? Well, if you have some simple SQL application, then the only thing that you have to do is pass environmental variables SQL v PI CUDA. And that means that force the device selection to use the CUDA backend and not the OpenCL one, just to make sure you don't end up using the Nvidia OpenCL implementation if you have it. And that's it. That will just work, and there's nothing you have to change in your code unless you need to do something CUDA specific. Right. So let's talk about the overall design aspects of SQL for CUDA. So everything started a long time ago in a Kronos specification far away, when we started looking at the SQL 1.2.1 programming model as a good programming model for heterogeneous architectures beyond OpenCL, and just more focused on C++. That was not the original intention of SQL, and we always focused on having OpenCL as the only target. But given that we have gained a lot of popularity in the C++ side of things, we started thinking that maybe we could have an open discussion about SQL for non-OpenCL platforms. So obviously, if you're in Kronos, the first thing that you're going to say is, let's do Balkan. Balkan is going to be more complicated than just doing OpenCL. First of all, it's because SQL was never designed for graphics. If you want to play around with it, you can technically just use OpenCL CLVK platform and just use CLSPRV to compile your kernels. With some hacking, you can get it working, but it's not the main target of what we're trying to do here. But the alternative is just to use CUDA. So we have the existing OpenCL PTX path available on CompuCP, but our experience with it was not great. Performance was always a problem. It was difficult to maintain because you need to maintain your PTX backend, but there's no customer base for it. We cannot just sell a CompuCP for OpenCL. And we quickly realized that having native CUDA support will be a much better way to expand the ecosystem beyond the hardware that is supported by OpenCL. So we decided to rethink the SQL 1.2.1 specification as a base and what we will need to change to get it running for CUDA. So conceptually, what kind of things can work? So the platform model, the idea of having a platform, a device, and a context that can work, because effectively it's just a matter of visualizing the topology of the system. The idea of having buffers, copy operations, and queuing commands to a queue, that's the same, that still works. And the nd-range kernel concept, just dispatching a kernel, or that is the same, roughly, although the configuration is slightly different. The idea is the same, you just have to change the numbers that you pass for the local versus the shared memory. There are things that, however, cannot work. So, for example, SQL 1.2.1 has a lot of interoperability functions, but on CUDA you just don't have the OpenCL types. So interoperability cannot be done straight away. Images and samplers, they cannot work. So in OpenCL, images are sampled in the kernel, so you can set an image and then you can use different samplers for it. But in CUDA, images are sampled on construction on the host. That's a very different way of doing things. and even the compilation mode for the PT exchanges if you want to do one or the other. So instead of emulating it and not having any performance, we decided just to not expose this feature on CUDA at the moment. And the other thing that is not really implementable is the SQL program class. So the OpenCL compilation model that is what the SQL program class is based on, just doesn't match CUDA at all. And they have, like, for example, options are not strings, and there's no online compilation per se. So we decided not to implement that part. So what we have done is, for everything that cannot be implemented or needs some tweaking, we have created a number of proposals and provide feedback to the SQL working group. And the SQL working group will try to make those implementable on a future SQL version. So some of the things we have done is part of this main outcome of this project, which has been the SQL generalization. That's how we call a proposal. And the idea is that the next version of SQL is going to be like sitting on top of different backends. So one is going to be the host backend, which simply runs on the host as a C++ application. The other one could be an OpenCL backend or a CUDA backend, and they will be optional, so you can have one or the other or both. And then that has different implications on how the programming model works now, and there is a concept of what is a SQL general application versus a SQL interoperability application, and all of this is explained on the SQL generalization proposal. And there will be much more details on the SQL next aspect once it is public. The other big proposal that came out of this is the SQL model objects, which is a replacement of the program class. The idea is that a module is like a container of different device images. So a device image could be the SPIRV binary, but you can also have some custom specific ISA or some SPIRV with bug symbols. And all of these device images represent the same group of kernels. So it's a very high level abstraction. It's not necessarily a mapping of a SPIRV or an LLVM module. The proposal is public there, but there could be changes after it goes through the SQL working group and we get more feedback from users and from the community. One of the main things we want to enable is for CUDA developers to use existing ecosystem libraries like Coblast or CUDA or CUDNN inside of their SQL applications. So this requires to extend the capabilities of SQL so that it can execute command groups that contains operations that run on the host but have dependencies on the device, which basically means that the data for this operation is on the device, but it is the host CPU that has to dispatch the kernel. So one of the proposals that we have made is to have a new type of command group or API entry that is called the host task. So the host task allows you to pass a lambda, and this lambda executes on the host. For example, here we are just reading a file and filling in the accessor with the data that is coming from the file. And this will execute asynchronously from the host when you submit it on the command group. And it will, the SQL runtime will figure out the dependencies and put the data in the right places so that the file can be written efficiently. And it has other implications that you can see in the text of the proposal, but you have some alternative ways of accessing the host data, and we'll show an example later on how this is used to access Kublas and operate with existing native libraries. Right, let's move to look in a bit more detail of how the compilation of SQL for CUDA kernels works and how we have implemented this on LLVM. So obviously there's already support for CUDA on an LLVM tip that was contributed back by Google in 2016. This includes a CUDA runtime implementation and a PTX backend. So the part that is interesting for us is the PTX backend, because it's what we are going to be using to generate the code for the NVIDIA devices from the SQL code. Now, how does this work? The compilation process follows a similar one as the SPIRU one that is already on the PC++ for OpenCL. The major difference is that it never goes through a SPIRU step. We include now the built-in libraries. The production of the file follows a standard process for Clang, so you compile with your Clang driver, but you do it twice for each source file. So first you do it for the host, and then you do it for the SQL device. And that gives you two binaries, two intermediate binaries. One is the object file for the host, and the other one is the BC file that contains the device kernel. In this case, it's going to be NVIDIA PDX. Then what happens is we go through a tool that is called the bundler, and that puts in the same object file, it puts the host image and the device image. And we do that for every translation unit. So during the linking stage, the bundled objects are unbundled, is the opposite. So all the device bitcode files are linked together using LLVM link alongside with the lib device, which is the implementation of the buildings coming from the CUDA SDK. And also with libspirv that is provided by the libclc project that is forking in the PC++. The resulting file is optimized and compiled to PTX. And the PTX is then assembled using PTX.as, and a CUDA FAT binary is produced using FATBIN. The CUDA FAT binary is wrapped into a host object file, which includes the FAT binary and any required symbols so it can be found by the SQL runtime. The final step is the platform linker, which can produce the final binary as either application or a library using the host object and the wrapped CUDA code, generating a binary that contains the CUDA binary, the CUDA kernels. Now, another piece of work that is worth highlighting on the compiler is the conversion from the SQL local memory allocations into CUDA shared memory allocations. Now, for different historic reasons, SQL only allows allocation of local memory before kernel dispatch. You can have multiple allocations of local memory, and for example, in OpenCL, you can also do this. Each individual local memory allocation or reservation is passed as an individual argument to the OpenCL kernel, and or as an individual accessor to the SQL kernel. Now, this is not how this works in CUDA natively. The closest thing you can see is the shared memory using the dynamic shared memory declarations. In this mode of using the CUDA shared memory, then you create an external array, and then you just pass different pointers that will represent the different data, but there is only one allocation. And then when you dispatch your kernel, then you pass an additional argument that is the total size of the local memory or shared memory in the CUDA concept that is going to be required for the kernel to execute. Now, how do we reconcile the two? Well, we have written a pass that transforms local to shared transformation. The first thing that it does is to create a global symbol to the CUDA shared memory allocation space. So that's a kernel shared external data space that is on local memory. The next thing that happens is that we replace the input pointers with integers. That is going to be the offsets that are used for offsetting into the shared memory location. And then finally, whenever there is an usage of a pointer inside of the kernel, we replace it by just the offset into the shared memory that we have pre-allocated here. And this allows us just to have the same SQL way of doing local memory, but just working with shared memory in the PTX. Let's take a look now at how things work at runtime and how the PC++ will interact with the CUDA runtime. This diagram, extracted from the DPC++ documentation in the Intel repo, shows how the runtime execution of a SQL application works. The SQL application, that contains different device binaries for SPDV or PTX or any other target, is linked to the DPC++ runtime library. That is implemented on the SQL API, and that's what we call, in the SQL spec, the SQL runtime. It does all the scheduling, memory management, device management, etc. Now, the DPC++ runtime library does not target OpenCL directly, but something that they call the plugin interface, the PI interface. The PI interface is a thin layer that is based in OpenCL. It's almost a one-to-one mapping among the two, but there's a few differences and some slight semantic changes. There's a number of mechanisms on the SQL runtime that allows for discovery and loading of different PI plugins. So what we have done here is we have created a PI plugin for CUDA that uses the CUDA driver API. So during discovery, you will have your PI OpenCL plugin that allows you to use your OpenCL devices in a normal way, but you will also have a different PI CUDA plugin that is going to be used for the CUDA devices. Now, in terms of SQL, they will appear as different platforms, but the driver version is going to be different. One is going to be OpenCL driver version, and the other one is going to be the CUDA backend for the PI. So there are minimal changes to the overall SQL runtime required for customers for the CUDA driver, mainly to deal with device code, device selection, and with some extensions. But most of the DPC++ runtime library can remain unchanged, and all of the platform-specific code can go to the CUDA driver API. So now remember that we are only covering here SQL 1.1 specification and what can be done in CUDA. So there is no interoperability that you can see, which means there is no change to the SQL API exposed at this point. But obviously we will have to do that in the future. So here we see an example of a PI function, the PI main buffer create. This is defined on the PI headers, and the thing is creating a PI main object. Now for the OpenCL plugin, the only thing that happens is that when you call PI main buffer create, you call internally CL buffer create. And your buffer your OpenCL buffer, your CL main object, and your CL OpenCL context, they are just casted back to PI object because there's a one-to-one mapping between the OpenCL objects and the PI objects. But from the SQL runtime perspective, everything is PI. So what happens with the PI CUDA plugin? Well, first of all, it's no longer a one-to-one mapping. So we need to have an implementation. So the actual implementation of the CUDA PI main buffer create is on the PI SCPP file, and that has all the entries for the PI plugin implementation and all the code that is needed for the plugin. The second thing to highlight is that now on the implementation, all the inputs are assumed to be correct because the client for this API is not the final user, it's a SQL runtime. And the SQL runtime can check the incorrect entries to the API using asserts. And that gives us a little bit more flexibility on what we can do with the inputs. So in this particular case for the PI main buffer create, now we have to create the scope for the context. So what we do is we activate the context on the thread. It's important to note that the CUDA driver API uses contexts that are active on the current thread. So you have to activate it when you want to do operations on the context. And after you have done it, then you just use your normal CUDA operations. So if you are using the use host host pointer flag, you just call the CU mem host register. And otherwise, you assume a normal CUDA memory allocation. And this is all the CUDA code that is needed for this. Now, after we have created the CUDA memory allocation, we need to create the PI metadata. So what we do is we construct a PI main object, which is a struct that contains different information that is required for the CUDA driver and the PI plugin to talk to each other and have all the information. So for example, a PI main object has a pointer to a context. In case it is a subbuffer or a partition like it's called in the PI, it has a pointer to the parent buffer, and it has some other information required for mapping, the reference counting, and various other things. So all of this is the minimal information that we need to keep functionality, and we try to keep all the metadata as little intrusive as possible, if that makes sense. One of the most important parts of using SQL for CUDA is the ability to use the very rich and widely used ecosystem of libraries and applications for the hardware. So we have designed some mechanisms to enable using the native CUDA libraries in SQL. Let's talk a little bit about them. So how can you use native libraries in SQL? So there's no native support in SQL and Boot 1.1. But in Codeplay we designed an extension called interrupt task that has been in CompuCP for a long time. And this adds you a new API entry called interrupt task, to which you can pass a lambda that contains code that is going to be executed on the host. So you can call a third party API that is used for, I don't know, interact with the OpenCL libraries or anything that can be executed on the host but has side effects on the device. The command group will execute using the normal SQL dependencies mechanism. So the accessors that are used here are the ones that are going to determine the order of execution. And then what you can do as well is for all the relevant API entries, you can use the handle get queue, for example, to get the OpenCL command queue, or for a given accessor, you can retrieve the OpenCL main objects. So if you want to call OpenCL library, you can just use the handles for it. So this allows you to integrate nicely without having to operate with OpenCL events and similar things. So now in CUDA you can do the same. We have ported this extension to the DPC++ runtime with some minor extensions. So you still have the interrupt task API entry, and you still have your interrupt handler. But now you can also, instead of just using OpenCL type, you can get back any type, and you can just pass a templated type that you want. And in this case, you can use get mem and give you back an accessor with a handle, and you can also get the handle for a particular queue. So for example, here we are just calling Kublas, which is a very popular CUDA library, using the native types for the memory. And it works as you would expect, as a normal CUDA call. But instead of having to manually synchronize and work with events or streams, we simply use the SQL dependency graph to schedule the task into the DAG, and the SQL runtime will handle everything automatically, which saves a lot of typing. Right, so let's conclude with some final thoughts and lines in future work. Here you can see some preliminary results of my local build of a CUDA backend for DPC++. I'm using Babel String 3.4, this is deep version on the repo, on a CUDA 10.1 platform with a GeForce GTX 980. The bars represent the bandwidth, so higher is better. Orange is the DPC++ CUDA backend running the SQL Stream benchmark. Green is playing CUDA Stream benchmark, and light blue is OpenCL Stream running on CUDA. So you can see there is still a gap in performance, especially in dots, but also there's a bit of a gap here. But the difference for everything except dot is less than 10%, despite of the early status of the work. So we think this is really encouraging, given the fact that we haven't focused on performance so far. So this this yellow line that I have added here is the internal level membranes that we have. It's using a different implementation for the event synchronization mechanism. So now you can see that the gap is gone on all cases, or pretty much gone. This is still a little bit of difference. So it's much closer to native. This is still in progress, but hopefully we will get this to reach tip soon, alongside other performance improvements that we will hope this will make the performance results comparable. So on this presentation, we have some the DPC++ CUDA backend, how it is implemented, how you can use it, and some early performance numbers, very early. DPC++ is a working SQL 1.2.1 compiler with many extensions, enables one API features that is very useful for experiment and to get a feeling of what could this next SQL spec look like. CUDA backend is already integrated into main trunk and is part of the DPC++ release process. It's an early prototype, but at least you can start using it on CUDA platforms without requiring OpenCL support. We are very pleased to see a lot of comments and involvement from the community. There's people reporting issues, and some people has even contributed pull requests and the new features, so it's very encouraging to see this happening. Our main focus is getting features in and working towards conformance as much as we can in SQL 1.2.1. We already discussed that there were some things that were not possible, but we'll get it as close as complete as we can. And then we can start looking into specific optimizations and things to improve. And the last thing is just to call everyone that is now sitting at home without anything to do to join us on the Intel LLVM repo and contribute to the project. You can report issues, you can have your feature request, or you can just review or just go there and say hello. This is my GitHub username, but most of our Codeplay folks, we have the same VR, so it will be very easy to identify us. And that's it. Thank you very much for watching this, and stay safe.